Hi there, I'm Nia Malika Henderson, and this is On Background. Terry McAuliffe narrowly defeated Tea Party favorite Ken Cuccinelli in Virginia's hotly contested governor's race. Is Virginia the swing state to watch for 2016? At the national level, Cuccinelli's loss might actually be a win for the GOP. Kyle Condit is the managing editor of Sabatow's Crystal Ball at the University of Virginia Center for Politics. He joins me now for a deep dive on Virginia politics. Kyle, thank you so much for joining me today. Let's look at this race. Basically, 2.5 points was the spread, about 55,000 votes for McAuliffe. Were you surprised? Why were we surprised? It was, you know, 6 or 7 points that we were thinking, based on the polls that were out there, that McAuliffe would win by. Why so close?
So thanks for having me. The public polling averages showed McAuliffe up about 6 or 7 points, and obviously ended up only winning by 2.5 points. Now, what's interesting is that the McAuliffe campaign's internal polls suggested that McAuliffe would win by maybe 4 points or so. So he sort of undershot the McAuliffe polls by just a little bit, but not by a ton. I think one thing that threw off the public polls in this race was that Robert Sarvis, the Libertarian, ended up winning about 7% of the vote. And I think he just sort of messed up the polls, for lack of a better term. And the fact that you had a third party candidate getting so many votes just sort of threw things off a little bit. I also do think that we had a really good national climate for Democrats at the start of October, mid-October, because of the shutdown. And then we saw the national environment sour for Democrats in the later part of October, I think a lot because of Obamacare and the president's declining approval. And so you put those things together and it adds up to McAuliffe not doing quite as well as we thought. But, you know, he still won. And as the results were coming in, you know, it became pretty clear that he was going to win. It was close, but it wasn't a real nail biter.
That's right. Let's look at the map here of what this victory looked like, and then talk a bit about the demographics. You have McAuliffe doing well in Northern Virginia, as people thought he would, and in strongholds like Richmond as well. Who showed up to vote?
So I think that this electorate was not as good for Democrats as 2012, but better for Democrats than it was in 2009 when Bob McDonnell won this race in a rout. The percentage of voters who were non-white was 28%, according to exit polls. In 2012, it was 30%, but 28% is still a good base of non-white voters for a Democrat to build off of. And of course, as we've seen in other races, Democrats do particularly well with non-white voters.
Right.
And look, there's just so many people and so many there's such explosive growth among Democratic demographics in places like Northern Virginia, and also I would say to a lesser extent Hampton Roads and the greater Richmond area, that Cuccinelli was able to clean up in Southwest Virginia and the rural part of the state, but the margins in the urban parts of the state were just too much for him to overcome.
And you very much had a full court press from Obama, Barack Obama, and Michelle Obama, and Biden too. I think Michelle Obama actually cut a radio ad that aired in some of those parts. Let's look at women as well in terms of how McAuliffe was able to do. He got 67% of unmarried women to Cuccinelli's 29%, married women. Cuccinelli did better, 51% to 42%. That's typical, but that's also seems like a very large gap. Democrats do tend to do better with unmarried women, but my goodness, what a blowout.
Yeah, and you know, you have to wonder if this is where Cuccinelli's pretty staunch social conservatism hurt him, in that unmarried women who, you know, didn't like his positions on abortion and gay marriage and those sorts of issues. You have to wonder if this is where that really hurt. And again, unmarried women demographic, I think a lot of those folks are young professionals in Northern Virginia who, you know, may have been inclined to vote for another kind of Republican.
Right.
But Cuccinelli, I think, was just probably too socially conservative for them.
And what's your sense? I think the saying often is with national campaigns, at least, as goes Ohio, so goes the nation. Can we now look at Virginia as a similar bellwether state in terms of national demographics and trends?
Sure, I think we can. I mean, in 2008 and 2012, Virginia was the state that came closest to the national average in the presidential race. I think what may be interesting, though, is that Ohio has been a national presidential bellwether for the last century, basically, and yeah. Virginia only has for the last two elections. One wonders if demographic change in Virginia will actually push it to be even more of a Democratic state, whereas Ohio would sort of stay as a slightly Republican-leaning national bellwether. So, we'll have to see what happens because, you know, Virginia's demographics are – Virginia sort of mirrors what's happening in the country at large in terms of growth of non-white voters. But it may become that Virginia's, Virginia is actually sort of ahead of the curve on that. And that if Republicans want to win the presidency, they're going to have to win it in whiter states that have traditionally been more Democratic, like Pennsylvania and Wisconsin and some of those Democratic-leaning Midwestern swing states.
Talking to Cal Condic about Virginia, tell me this. What's your sense of what this means for McAuliffe and his governorship? For instance, now you have Mark Herring and Mark Obeshane locked in a battle over who's going to be the next AG. I think they're separated by something like 200 votes. That, to me, speaks to the great divide that McAuliffe is going to face as governor.
Yeah, I mean, look, Democrats didn't really make any real inroads in the House of Delegates last night in Virginia. And so Republicans still have a towering majority in the House of Delegates. The Senate is very close. In fact, there's going to be at least one special election for Lieutenant Governor-elect Ralph Northam's Senate seat. That's going to be very close. But the Senate could basically be evenly split or even basically controlled by Democrats. So, it's going to be hard for McAuliffe to assemble a governing majority. I think that the big policy achievement that McAuliffe is probably going to go for is Medicaid expansion. But the question is will Republicans in the House of Delegates actually play along with McAuliffe? And that's a big open question. The Speaker of the Virginia House of Delegates, Bill Howell, put out a kind of very grudging statement last night about McAuliffe's victory that didn't really suggest that Speaker Howell or the Republicans in the House of Delegates really wanted to work with them
right.
All that much.
So Obamacare looming large there for McAuliffe, the same thing you imagine for 2014 in terms of Obamacare?
You know, it could be. There's a lot of conflicting signs out there right now. You know, obviously, the first part of October was very good for Democrats. The second part of October was good for Republicans. Is this race really a bellwether? Kind of hard to say. I mean, one stat that's interesting here is that McAuliffe, for all his weaknesses as a candidate, he actually broke a trend of Virginia voting against the president's party
right.
in the gubernatorial race that had gone back to the late 70s. And so that's kind of impressive, and it's impressive in that the president is not popular, and yet this race ended up not being a referendum on him, because if it was, Cuccinelli would have won.
Yeah, awesome. For chatting with me today, Kyle, I appreciate you for being here. Kyle Condic, all things Virginia, I appreciate it.
Thank you.